हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ न्यू चैप्टर ऑफ साइंस एंड द नेम ऑफ दिस इज पीरियोडिक क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ एलिमेंट्स और पीरियोडिक टेबल। पीरियोडिक टेबल। नाउ एज द नेम गोज, व्हाट इज अ पीरियोडिक टेबल और व्हाट इज दिस चैप्टर ऑल अबाउट? वी नो दैट वी कैटेगराइज आवर क्लोथ्स, दैट दिस क्लोथ इज फॉर स्कूल, दिस क्लोथ्स आर फॉर गोइंग ट्यूशन, दिस क्लोथ्स आर फॉर गोइंग टू अ पार्टी, दिस क्लोथ्स आर गोइंग टू अ मार्केट। वी कैटेगराइज आवर क्लोथ्स, है ना? वी पुट इट इन डिफरेंट सेक्शन सो दैट इट इज बेटर फॉर, इट इज इजियर फॉर अस टू सर्च द क्लोथ्स इन नीड, और सो दैट वी कैन group them that this clothes must be used less, this clothes must be used more, this has more importance, this has less importance, etc. Similarly, we group elements, we group chemical elements according to their chemical properties, that this has a same property, this will do a same property, this will do a same property. So depending on their properties, we divide a chemical element into groups. This group is known as periodic table. So the first attempt of arranging groups, arranging elements in groups were done by Mr. Jobernier. So the first attempt was done by Mr. Jobernier. What did he? What was his contribution? He was the first one to at least attempt to make an attempt to create a classification of elements. Before that, no one ever did the classification. Whatever he did was wrong. It was later recognized that whatever he did was wrong. But at least he gave a first attempt to do the things. What he told? He told that elements are arranged in such a way that the atomic mass, I am repeating, atomic mass or the mass number of the first and the third will be the atomic mass of the middle. Suppose there are elements A, B, C, then atomic mass of A plus C by 2 will be equals to atomic mass of B. This is how he arranged elements in group of 3. That's why it is known as triads. He arranged the elements in group of 3 in such a way that the mass of the first and the last by 2 means the mean of the first and the last will be the mean of will be the mass of the middle one. So this was his classification. Now there were certain drawbacks. What was the drawback? That he only could arrange 15 elements, means 3 into 5. Only 5 groups could be arranged like this. And what about the other elements? He could not explain the bit. So that was the first disadvantage. The second disadvantage was that whatever atomic masses he did the experiment or he did his calculation depending on atomic masses or the mass number, whatever mass number he took were faulty, were not correct. So this calculation was also faulty. So this was totally rejected. His way of grouping was totally rejected. First, because he could only classify 15 elements. What about the others? And rest, the atomic masses that was taken by him was not correct. It was faulty. So due to this, the Jobernier law of triads was a failure. But why do we learn about it? If it is a failure, if it is wrong, then what is the importance of learning it? The importance is that he was the first person who gave us the idea that yes, we can also classify elements. So the first one, Jobernier. The next one was Mr. Newland. He gave the law of octaves. What was that law? According to the law of octaves, he took 7 elements. ओके, सच ए वे दैट द एट्थ एलिमेंट विल रिपीट द फर्स्ट वन, नाइन्थ वन विल रिपीट द सेकेंड वन, टेंथ वन विल रिपीट द थर्ड वन एंड सो ऑन. मीन्स एवरी एट्थ एलिमेंट विल रिपीट द गिवन एलिमेंट. द वन विल बी रिपीटेड बाई एट, टू विल बी रिपीटेड बाई नाइन, थ्री विल बी रिपीटेड बाई टेन, फोर विल रिपीटेड बाई इलेवन, फाइव बाई ट्वेल्व, सिक्स बाई थर्टीन एंड सेवन बाई फोर्टीन. सो ही ग्रुप इन लाइक सेवन एंड सो ऑन इट ग्रुप. ही फॉर्म्ड अ टेबल ऑफ एलिमेंट्स इन सच ए वे दैट देयर वेयर सेवन एलिमेंट्स इन अ रो एंड एवरी एट्थ एलिमेंट विल रिपीट द गिवन एलिमेंट. ओके, नाउ ही जस्ट फॉर्म अ टेबल लाइक दिस. He formed a table like this. There was a table. Where this was followed by this, this is and so on. So his way of classifying was a bit noteworthy. People also liked it, but there again there were errors in it. What was the first error? The first error was that he only took seven columns and eight rows. The total he took only 56 elements that were present at that time. Then what about the remaining ones? He only took 7 into 8, 56 elements. At he took 15, he took 56. Then what about the elements that were yet to be discovered? Jo abhi tak discover nahi hua, wo elements kahan jayega? He did not left any blank spaces for it. Next, he told that the elements are increased in, he arranged the elements in such a way that they were placed as per their increasing atomic masses. The elements were increasing in, were set up in such a way that they were placed by their increasing atomic masses. Means this atomic mass must be, this one is greater than this one, then this is again greater than this one. This means the increasing order. Then again this is also in increasing order. So he placed the atomic number, he placed the elements in such a way that the atomic masses or the mass numbers were in increasing order. And finally he told that every eighth element should repeat the first element. So these were some of his conclusions. But what were the errors? The first I told you, he took only 56 elements and the remaining elements or the undiscovered elements were not given any place. Second, he told that the elements were increased in increasing order. But when we closely scrutinized or we closely noticed, we noticed that the elements were not so. The heavier elements were placed in the beginning and the lighter elements were placed in the back. Why? To maintain that the every eighth element will repeat the first. So this will be repeated by this. Similarly, this will be repeated by this and this will be repeated by this. So this will be repeated by this, this will be repeated by this. So this whole column should be same. To maintain this same column, what he did? He placed some elements with higher atomic number in the beginning and a higher atomic mass in the beginning and elements with the lower atomic mass or lighter atomic mass in the back. So his word, what he told? He told that every element is arranged in increasing order. That order was not maintained. So that was his shortcoming. He could not even maintain his own conclusion. So what was the achievement of Newland? He included all the elements that were present. The 56, all the elements were present. He arranged the elements in such a way that they were being placed in increasing order of atomic masses and every eighth element will repeat the given element. Means in all the column the elements will be of the same property, but the same things were not followed. There were certain shortcomings in Newland's period table. The first one, he only placed 56 elements. The remaining undiscovered elements were not given any place. Second, to make them follow the same trend or to make them follow the same chemical properties, he placed the elements in haphazard way, that the heavier elements were placed in the beginning and the lighter elements were placed in the end. So this was the problem in it. So this was again modified by another scientist whose name was Mendeleev. Mendeleev. What he did? He just improved the law of octaves. He didn't give his own law. He just improved the law of octaves. There was no separate law for Mendeleev. Okay, so no new law. He gave no new law. So what he did? He did something that was very interesting. Newland took 7 elements. He took 8 elements. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and the last one was a special element. He made all the noble gases in a separate column. He placed the noble gases in a separate column. All the noble gases were placed separately at the last. He did not place the noble gas with the 7 because the noble gas does not react with anything. So it is very difficult for them to maintain a position. So he placed the noble gas separately. That was the first achievement. The second achievement, he left empty spaces in between. Wherever he thought that there must be an element present, he left empty spaces. He told that the more importance should be on the arrangement of the elements, not on the increasing order. So he did not paid attention to increasing order. He told that the elements must be placed as the increasing order of atomic masses. But Mendeleev told no, increasing order of atomic mass is not so important. But the property, maintenance of property of the same column is very important. So he placed all the elements of the same column as same property. Okay, so every column had the same property and the atomic or the noble gases were also placed as separate. So these also have the same property. Noble gases does not react with anything. So he made more or less a well-designed periodic table. But again, he did the same mistake that he calculated or he made every conclusion depending on the atomic masses. You know, na, that the atomic mass of two elements can be same. But the atomic numbers are unique. That thing he didn't consider. He only took the atomic masses. And atomic masses of two elements could be same. Even two elements, same element having the same atomic number but different, the isotopes. The isotopes may be of the same element but they have different masses. So what he did, he placed the same element but with two isotopes at two different positions. That was one of the mistakes that he did. The isotope, for example, isotope chlorine. Chlorine has two isotopes. One is 17Cl35 and 17Cl37. Both are chlorine. But what did Mendeleev consider? Mendeleev considered the atomic masses, not the atomic numbers. Atomic numbers are same, but Mendeleev took 35 and 37. As these two things are different, he considered these two gases as different. He didn't consider chlorine, these are the both isotopes of chlorine. So 35Cl was placed in a separate position and 37Cl was placed in a separate position. The same element was repeated twice. Means the problem of isotopes remain in the table of Mendeleev. The second problem, he could not specify the fixed position of hydrogen. Because hydrogen is such an element that it can even be placed at group 1 and it can be placed at group 7. So that was the second problem. And third, in order to make the column as same, column containing the same property, he placed two elements in the same box. That is, if I make a table of here, then each box must be containing only one element. In order to satisfy his conclusion that all the elements of the same column are same, he even put two different elements in the same box. So that was his third mistake or third demerit. The first demerit, he placed isotopes at two different positions. Whereas later we could know that isotopes are the same element but only having different atomic masses. Second, he could not specify the fixed position of hydrogen because the hydrogen, once he placed hydrogen as the first group and then he placed hydrogen as the seventh group. Both the places the hydrogen could be placed. And thirdly, in order to maintain his column of same property, he even put two different elements at the same box, which should not happen. A box should contain only one element. That was his third disadvantage. So all of these three made mistakes, but they gave us an idea that how could we arrange the elements. Mr. Daubonnier, Newland and Mendeleev. Daubonnier gave the law of triads, Newland gave the law of octaves, and Mendeleev didn't give any law, but he rectified the table made by Mr. Newland. So who was the person who rectified all the errors and made a perfect periodic table? That was Mr. Moseley. So, he gave a new law. What is the law? Modern periodic law. What does this law states? This law states that the elements of a periodic table must be placed in such a way that they will obey their properties depending on the atomic number rather than the atomic mass. He proved or he gave a law that all the properties of an element were based on their atomic numbers, not on their atomic masses. And we know that the atomic number of each element is unique. Hence, if the atomic numbers are considered, no two elements can be repeated. All the elements will be placed uniquely at a box. So that was the only thing that these all people made a mistake. But that was rectified by Mr. Moseley. Moseley told that all the periodic properties, means all the chemical properties of an element must be based on their atomic number rather their atomic masses. And this law is known as modern periodic law. So what he did? He did the same thing that Mendeleev did. He just rectified how the element should be placed. He made a periodic table based on atomic numbers. Similar to Mendeleev, he placed all the noble gases at the last and he made total of 18 columns. He made total of 18 columns and total of 7 rows. So what he did? He did total number of 18 columns. He made 8 columns, he made 18 columns and 7 rows. This is how he classified all the elements depending on their chemical, depending on their atomic numbers rather than their atomic masses. And this is known as modern periodic law. That's why Moseley's periodic table is also known as modern periodic table. Correct. So this is how the periodic table has taken its shape. Now, we have to study in details the modern periodic table. Discussed, modern periodic table is considering of 18 columns and 7 rows. See. हाँ, सो आई हैव ड्रॉन अ टेबल कंटेनिंग 18 रोज एंड 7 18 कॉलम्स एंड 7 रोज. दिस कॉलम्स आर नोन एज ईच ऑफ दिस इज नोन एज अ ग्रुप. सो देयर फोर दीज आर नोन एज ग्रुप. सो देयर आर हाउ मच? देयर आर 18 ग्रुप्स. 18 ग्रुप्स एंड दीज आर ऑल नोन एज पीरियड. सो देयर आर 7 पीरियड्स. सो यू शुड लर्न और यू शुड रिमेंबर दैट द कॉलम्स आर नोन एज ग्रुप्स. सो देयर आर 18 ग्रुप्स एंड द रोज आर नोन एज पीरियड्स. हेंस दे आर 7 पीरियड्स. द पीरियड्स आर इट्स डिजाइन इन सच ए वे दैट द पीरियड 1 contains only 2 elements. The period 1 contains only 2 elements. Period 2 and 3, they contain 8 elements each. Period number 4 and 5, they contain 18 elements each. And period number 6 and 7, they contain 18 plus elements. Means they contain more elements than 18. Why? Because this period 1 elements contain the elements only at the first position and at the 18th position, the first and the last. Period 2 contains elements from 1, 2 and then 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18. Period 4 and 5, they are the complete periods. Means they will contain all the elements in the all the columns. And period 6 and 7, they are divided from here. They are divided and placed separately in other table. These two tables are known as lanthanide and actinide series. What I told, that the period 6 and 7 are so long that they cannot be accommodated in 18 places. So what Moseley did, he placed the elements separately in two tables. That from here he took an arrow and placed outside. From here he took an arrow and placed outside. These two series are known as, the upper one is known as lanthanide series. Lanthanide series, and the below one is known as actinide series. Lanthanide and actinide series. They contains 18 and plus, there may be 10 or 12 elements. So they contain more than 18 elements, period number 6 and 7. Period number 1, only 2 elements, they are very short element, very short periods. Period 2 and 3 contains 8 elements each, they are short periods. Period 4 and 5 are called complete periods or long periods. And period 6, 7 are known as incomplete periods, because I have placed certain elements outside it. Correct. Now these were what periods. What about groups? The group 1. Group 1 is known as alkali metals. Group 2, they are alkaline earth metals. Okay, group 3 to 12, they are transition elements. Group 14, 15, they are metalloids. Basically 14, but 15 is also sometimes taken into consideration. Then group 17, there is a special one. The group 13 and group 16 are basically metals and non-metals, so that's why I have not included them. Group 17, they are known as halogens. And group 18, they are the noble gases. So I have to explain the important ones. Group 13 and 16 are metals and non-metals. Group 13 are metals and group 16 are ordinary non-metals. So there is no special about them. So what is this? What are the specialties about these groups? Group 1, the first group, is always alkali metals. Why? Because they directly, these metals directly react with water to form alkali. They don't have to be created as oxides. Then the second one, the group 2 are known as alkaline earth metals because they are found as ores in earth, but they are alkaline or basic in nature. The group 3 to 12 are transition elements. Why is a transition? Because from 3 to 12, they don't generally follow the trends that we are going to discuss now. We will discuss periodic trends after this. So this 3 to 12 does not generally follow the trends. That's why they are known as transition elements. Then group 14, 15 are metalloids. The middle one, the 14th. The 14th element is, the 14th one is generally metalloids. But certain metalloids are also placed in the 15th. You know what is metalloids? Metalloids are the elements which contain the properties of both metals and non-metals. Then we are moving to group 17. Group 17 is known as halogens, the second last one. The group 17, the second last one is called the halogen because they are the most active non-metals. Group 17 are the most active non-metals of the periodic table. And group 18 is called the noble gas because, last one, this is a noble gas because they do not react with anything. So this is the complete description of the modern periodic table. What he has done, how many rows he has taken, the rows are known as groups, the rows are known as periods. How many columns he has taken, the columns are known as groups. So now, from now, you won't tell columns and rows. Rather, you will say groups and periods. There are 18 groups and 7 periods. Correct? So, this is the explanation of Moseley's modern periodic table. Now, what we were discussing? We were discussing the trends in the modern periodic table. Now, what do you mean by trends? Hana, you also know the trending video, trending challenge. Now this it was very trending in the cyberspace, na, that Dalogna coffee and something like that. So what is this trend means? Trend means if someone starts, everyone will follow after it. Trend means that na, someone or other, some of the celebrities or some of the popular person will start that thing and every other person will try to follow them. That's called a trend, trends. So, what that thing has to do with these elements? The same thing. The elements try to follow the properties that are given by another element. One of the elements will start and the other elements will follow the same. That is called the trends. So, how these trends are maintained in my periodic table? That's what I have to study here. The first trend is atomic size. The size is also followed, means the size of the atomic, the size of the atom or the atomic radius is followed by the elements. How? While we move down from top, my atomic size increases. Atomic size increases. And while I move from left to right, my atomic size decreases. Here decreases and here increases. So while I go down a group, my atomic size increases, and while I move across a period, the atomic size decreases. Now the question is why? Q, sir, why? Let me tell you with an example why this happens. Suppose the first element of the first group. The first one, hydrogen. Hydrogen has only one shell and only one electron. Hydrogen has only one electron. Then I have that below, lithium. Lithium has three electrons, means it will have like this. Two at the center and one at the end. Then I have sodium. Sodium has three shells. Then I have potassium. Potassium has four shells. So you can see, as I move down, the number of shells are increasing. The number of periods means the number of shells. Means this is the first period have only one shell, second period has two shell, third period has three shell, fourth period has four shell, fifth cell size, six cells and seven cells. So as I move down, the number of shells are increasing. And as the number of shells are increasing, the size is also increasing. So what is the reason for moving down a group? As we move down a group, the number of electron shells of an atom increases. As the number of electron shells increases, the size of the atoms also increases. Correct? But now, how then across a period the size decreases? So when I suppose I take the second one, there are eight elements. Everyone has two cells, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. Everyone has two shell each. Then why the size decreases from left to right? Why doesn't the size remain same? Let me tell. Here, lithium has only one electron in the outermost shell. Here, beryllium has two electrons in the outermost shell. Boron has three. Carbon has four. Nitrogen has five. Oxygen has six. Fluorine has seven. And neon has eight. So this is how my electrons are distributed. You should know that the electrons are negative in charge. And the central nucleus, they are positive in charge. And what will happen between the attraction between the electrons and protons? Electrons and the nucleus, because protons are present, negative and positive attract each other. So electrons will be attracted by the nucleus. As the number of electrons are increasing, their attraction power is also increasing, because as the electrons are increasing, protons are also increasing, because number of electrons and protons remain same. So as the electron and proton are increasing, their attractive charge, attractive power, because their nuclear charges are increasing. So due to this attraction, they come close to each other. Hence, as the number of electrons in the outermost radius increases, their attraction towards the nucleus also increases. And the attraction increases, they come a bit closer. That's why the size decreases as we move from left to right or across a period. So while we travel across a period, the number of shells remain same. But due to the nuclear charges, the attraction between the nucleus and the electrons increases. As a result, the outer electrons come closer to the nucleus and thus the size decreases. So this is how my atomic size is trending up down a group and across a period. Down a group, the size increases, while across a period, the size decreases. Then we have valency and valence electron. Valence electrons and valency. What is their trend? Down a group, So what I have written? I have written that down a group, the valency and valence electron, VE means valence electron, the valency and the valence electron both remain same down a group. But while I move across a period, the valence electron increases. See here, here was only 1, here 2, here 3, here 4. So as I move from left to right, my valence electron increases. But what about valency? Valency first increases but then decreases. Do you know why? Let me tell you. So suppose this one, why the valency and the valence electrons remains same. Suppose for the diagram, this has only one shell but only one electron in the outermost. Then lithium, it has two shells but only one electron. So the number of electrons in the outermost shell is one, and the number of electrons in the outermost shell is known as the valence electron. Here also sodium, three shells but only one electron in the outermost shell. Then potassium, four shells but one electron in the outermost shell. So all the elements in the first row will have one electron in the outermost shell. In the second, two, third, three, fourth, four, five, like this, it will go on. So this is how the number of electrons in the outermost shell and thus the valency of the same group remains same. Means up down a group, the valency and the valence electron remain same. But when we move across a period, you can see easily here that the number of electrons in the outermost shell is increasing. That is, my valence electron is increasing. But you know now, the valency is calculated by the formula. Valency equals to valence electron if valence electron is less than equals to 4. But valency equals to 8 minus valence electron if valence electron is greater than 4. So till here the valence electron is 1, here the valence electron is 2, here 3, here 4. So up to here the valency is equals to valence electron, because if the valence electron is less than equals to 4, then valency is equals to valence electron. So here my valency is increasing by one by one. But here how many electrons are there? There are 5 electrons. So what I will get? I will get 8 minus 5, that is equals to 3. Here I will get 8 minus 6, that is equals to 2. Here 8 minus 7, that is equals to 1. And here 8 minus 8, that is equals to 0. So the last group, that is the noble gas, that has valency 0. That's why it does not react with anything. Correct. So my valency increases first up to 4 and then it starts decreasing. So this is how my valency and valence electron trends down and across. The down a group, the valency and valence electron both remains same. But when I move across a period, then my valence electron will go on increasing one by one, but my valency will first increase up to 4 and then will start decreasing. So this is how, and as the valency remains same in the group, their chemical properties are also same, because the chemical properties are depending on the number of valence electron in the outermost shell. The elements having same number of valence electron in the outermost shell will have the same properties. That's why the elements in the same group have same valence electrons. Correct? Then we have metallic and non-metallic property. So the next topic is the next trend, that is metallic and non-metallic property. What is this metallic non-metallic property? So first I will write the trend and then I will explain. When we move down a group, and across a period, Okay. So this is the trend. What I wrote that when I move from top to bottom, my metallic properties increases while my non-metallic property decreases. And while I move from left to right or across a period, my metallic property decreases while my non-metallic property increases. Now, why is this all about? You already studied that when I move down a group, the size of the atom increases. The size of the atom increases. So, when I'm moving from top to bottom, suppose this is the case for this one. Here is only one electron. Here are two shells and also one electron. And here will be four shells and one electron. Okay? So this is how the shells are placed. As we move down, the number of shells are increasing, the size are increasing. Now you tell me, what will be the attraction? What will be the amount of attraction of this electron with this nucleus? This electron with this nucleus and this electron with this nucleus. As I am going far away from the nucleus, my attraction from the nucleus will decrease. Because there, as I, the number of electrons in the outermost shell is same, one. So it is being attracted by the nucleus, that's why it is placed at the same position. As I am going far away from the nucleus, what is happening? The attraction of the outermost electron from the nucleus goes off, decreasing and decreasing because it goes far and far away. So as it goes far away, it gains a tendency to move away from the nucleus. Means it can go out. And if you lose an electron, what will you become? The elements that lose electron becomes metallic. They become cation. So, as we move down, the tendency to lose electrons increases. That's why, as we move down, my metallic tendency increases. And my non-metallic tendency decreases because these two are complemented to each other. If metal will increase, then the non-metal will decrease. And as I move from left to right, what is happening? The size is becoming small and small. As I go from this to this, there are same number, but the size will become small. So, there are more number of electrons here. So, more will be the attraction. The electrons will not be able to go out very easily because the attraction from the nucleus is very high. Here is only one electron. So electron, all the electrons are not, here is one electron, here is eight electrons. These all the eight electrons will attract the nucleus, so the attraction will be very high. But here is only one, it cannot so much strongly pull the nucleus or attract the nucleus. So here the attraction will be less. So in this case, here the electron can easily move out, but here the electron cannot go out so easily. As a result, this will be, this will lose the electron easily and this will not lose the electron easily. As a result, this is more metallic and this is less metallic. That's why as I move across a period, my metallic tendency or my metallic property decreases while my non-metallic property increases. So this is also basically based on the size of the atom. As the size of the atom increases from top to bottom, the tendency or the attraction between the outermost electron and the nucleus decreases. As a result, the tendency of the atom to lose electrons also increases. As the atom loses electrons, it becomes a cation or it gains metallic property. And as the tendency to gain electron increases, the atom becomes a non-metal or the non-metallic tendency increases. This is known as my metallic and non-metallic property across and down a group. Now the last trend is what I wrote, electron affinity plus ionization potential. Though they are different, they have different definitions, but their trends are same. That's why I have written it as same. What are these things first? Electron affinity. What is the mean of affinity? Affinity means attraction. Affinity means attraction. What is the definition? Is electron attraction. Electron affinity. So I told the same here as itself. As I move down, as I move down the group, what will happen? As I move down a group, both of them increases. Sorry, my mistake. Both of them decreases. And if I move across a period, then both of them will increase. Means this is same as the metallic property, non-metallic property. Same as non-metallic property. Now, how is these two things related to non-metallic property? I told you electron affinity is the attraction towards electron. Now you tell me which substances attracts electrons. Non-metals attracts electrons, while metals have a tendency to lose electron. So as my non-metallic property decreases, increases, the electron affinity also increases or decreases. So as I move down a group, my non-metallic property decreases, hence my electron affinity also decreases. And when I move across a period, my non-metallic property increases and hence my electron affinity also increases. Then what's about ionization potential? Ionization potential or ionization energy or ionization enthalpy, these are all same words. Then what does this mean? Ionization energy means, or ionization potential means, the amount of energy required to convert an atom into an ion. The amount of energy required to convert an atom to an ion by losing an electron. To convert into an atom ion by losing an electron. So you tell me who has the more tendency to lose electron. As I move down, they have the more tendency to lose electron. As the tendency is more, the energy required to do the work will be less. Hai na? Suppose someone is having interest of going out, or someone is having interest to study, I will need less force to make him study. So they are having more tendency, they are having more interest to lose electron. So I won't need much energy to make this electron go out. I have to apply very less energy. But if I stop of this, they are having very less interest of losing. They are having interest to gain electron. They don't want to lose the electron. So I have to give more and more energy to persuade them that you please Baba, you lose the electron. So as I move down, this electron potential decreases. Or ionization potential decreases because the energy required to lose the ion, to lose the electron decreases. But as I move from left to right, they go on attracting electron. So if they are attracting electron, they won't easily lose electron. I have to persuade them, bhai, chhod do, electron chhod do. Means I have to give more and more energy. I have to persuade them, chhod do, you have to lose the electron. So they will require more energy. That's why when I will move from left to right, I will require more energy to lose an electron. That's why my ionization potential increases. And when I move from top to bottom, I will not require much energy to lose the electron. Therefore, my ionization potential decreases. So these are all the trends that you should know for doing this periodic table. Correct? Now, the question is, sir, how the question in the exam is going to be asked? Depending on this periodic trends. I am going to give you an example, and that shall be the end of this chapter. Let me give an example first. Okay, a very good question is found. So there is a table they have drawn and they have written certain elements. So this is the thing. Okay. So a table is given here. Okay. How the table is being drawn? Just like a periodic table, but instead of giving the direct names, the names of the elements are given as A, B, C, D and E, F, G. This is the A, this is B, this is C, this is D, this is E, this is F and this is G. So, these are the elements. The first question, which elements form only covalent bonds? The covalent bonds are the property of elements belonging to the carbon type of elements. They belong to the group which are basically having 4 electrons in the outermost shell. Why? Because the 4 electrons, they can gain electrons and they can also lose electrons, the same number. Plus 4 is also possible, minus 4 is possible. So instead of transfer of electrons, they do sharing of electrons. So covalent bond is the property of electrons having 4 as their valence electron or 4 electrons in the outermost shell. Now you tell me, which of these elements has 4 electrons in the outermost shell? That is the group number 14. Because this has 1, this has 2, 3 to 12 does not follow the rules. This has 3, this has 4 electrons, this has 5, this has 6, this has 7, this has 8. As the number of electrons in the outermost shell is 8, for group 18, it will have valency as 0 and that why 18 is a noble gas. So, I have 4 electrons for group number 14. So, this element E will have only covalent bonds. What is the second question? The second question is, name the metal with valency 2. Okay, so what are metals? If you remember that period 1, group 1, group 2, I told group 1, 2 and 13. Group 1, 2 and 13. These are metals. This is alkali metal, these are alkaline earth metals and these are the normal metals. Group 14 is metalloid. 15, 16, 17, these are non-metals. And 18 is the noble gas. Correct. So, what are the metals? These all elements will be metals. So, in this table, I have metals as A and D. These two are metals because all these are from this side. I am not getting any other thing. So, A and D are the metals. So, if there is a group 1, in group 1, I am having 1 as the outermost electron. So, the valence is also 1. But in group 2, I am having 2 as the valence electron. So, the valency is 2. So, the metal with valency 2 is D. Correct? Now, the next question. Oxide of metal A. Not metal, oxide of element A. Now A is a metal and oxide means oxygen. So this A belongs to group 1. So what is the valency? Valency is 1. And oxygen has valency 2. So if I form the oxide, what will happen? They will exchange their position and I will get A2O. This is the formula of oxide of element A. Then the question is, out of all, name the smallest and the largest atoms. Which one is the largest atom and which one is the smallest atom? So, as you know, as I move down from top to bottom, the number of shells are increasing. Here only one shell, here two shells, here three shells, here four shells. So as I am going down, the number of shells are increasing. So definitely, the elements of group 3, period 3, will have a larger size than elements of group 2. So these elements of 2 are smaller than 3. Now, 2 are smaller, 3 is larger. Now from these 3, I have 4 elements, B, E, G and F. Which one has the largest size? So as I told, as we move across a period, down a group ka kaam khatam ho gaya. I know, jaise niche utarte hai, size badhta hai. Means 3 ka zyada hoga, 2 ka chota hoga. Matlab 2 mein se koi ek sabse chota hoga, aur 3 mein se koi ek sabse bada hoga. Ab 3 mein kaun sabse bada hai? Ye janna hai. So as I move across a period, my size decreases. So this one is the smallest size and this one is the largest size. From these all. So the largest size is D. Okay, now from the second has only 2 shells, so it will be smaller than the 3. Now ab in tino mein se sabse chota kaun sa hai, A, B, C mein se sabse chota kaun sa hai? So I can easily see that when I move across a period from left to right, my size decreases. So in comparison of A, B and C, the C will have the smallest size. So the smallest of all elements is next. What is the common name of elements C and F? C and F are belong to the last group. The last group means the 18th group. What is the common name of the 18th group? It is known as noble gas. Yes or no? So, this is how my questions will be asked depending on the periodic trends. You will be given a table. Maybe you will be given the names of the original elements, or maybe you will be given the variables as X, Y, Z, A, B, C, anything. Then you will be asked questions depending on the trends, whether which one has a higher size, which one has more affinity, which one has more ionization potential, which will have more valency, what will be the valency of substrates, something like this. So you have to learn the trends very much before you can answer these types of questions. So basically, what all things we have studied? We have studied that what is classification elements, what are the types of classification done. The first one by Mr. Daubernier, then by Newland, then by Mendeleev, and finally by Moseley. What are the salient features of Moseley's periodic table, also known as the modern periodic table? And what are the 4 trends of the modern periodic table? That are the atomic size, the valency, the metallic normality character, and finally the electron affinity or the ionization potential. So that's all for this chapter. Thank you.